Every year, thousands of students let misconceptions about the financial aid process prevent them from applying and receiving the financial aid they deserve. Today, we're here to get to the bottom of it, get the straight answers and the truth about the financial aid process. I'm here with Phil Olsen. Phil is the Vice President of Financial Aid for AIU. He's an expert in financial aid. Under his leadership, he's served over 160,000 students as they've achieved the ability to earn over $200 million in financial aid eligibility. In addition to leading AIU's team of 80 financial aid advisors, Phil also sits on the Career Education Scholarship Fund and the Advantage Grant. Mm-hmm. Is that correct?
Yeah.
So welcome to Phil, and I'm Jennifer Ziegenmeier. I'm the Vice President of Student Experience for American Intercontinental University. Thanks for being with us today. So Phil, as I said, confusion about financial aid eligibility keeps many students from applying. Can you kind of walk us through some of the common misconceptions? For example, many students believe that having poor credit mm-hmm. could impact their eligibility for financial aid. Is that true?
No, it's not necessarily true. I think where the misconception comes in is that, you know, students feel that, you know, financial aid is made up of just loans, or is it just grants? And they're not certain of which it is and what it means to them. So the important thing is that you actually fill out a FAFSA application, which is going to determine your eligibility for Pell Grants and Federal Stafford Loans. If you do need to use Federal Stafford Loans, they will not be credit-based, so you actually just complete the application, you'd fill out a master promissory note, and then you'd work with your school to actually complete the rest of the process. But the short answer to that is no. Your credit score does not impact your eligibility for Stafford Loans.
What about on the other side of the coin, making too much money? Can you actually make too much money to be eligible for financial aid?
Yes and no. So, for example, there are students that who have a higher income that may not qualify for grants through the federal government, but the vast majority of folks do actually qualify for some kind of aid through a federal Stafford loan. There could be a difference in terms of whether the loan will be subsidized by the government or whether it will be unsubsidized, but I encourage everybody, regardless of their income level, to actually complete the application and see what's out there for them.
So you've mentioned the FAFSA a couple of times, which is the free application for federal student aid.
Yeah.
It's kind of a lengthy document. It's not a lot of fun. Do I have to fill out the FAFSA to receive financial aid?
Yeah, I hear you loud and clear. It's not the funnest document to complete. It can take about 30 to 45 minutes to complete it, but you do need it because without it, the government can't tell the school what you're eligible for in federal aid. So it does. It has gotten easier over the years. You can import your tax information straight into the document from the IRS nowadays, so it's a little bit faster. It used to take maybe an hour and a half, and now I would say, you know, if you use the import tool, you could probably get it done in 30 minutes.
Okay, so that's an improvement.
Yeah.
So for AIU, many of our students are actually adults. Mm-hmm. Many of them are working adults. Is there an age limit for applying and being eligible for financial aid?
No. There's no age limit in terms of cutting off your eligibility. On the other side of that coin, for younger students, it can impact whether or not they need to have their parents' information on the application and things like that. But when you go through the form, it'll basically tell you and it will guide you based on your dependency questions and tell you if you need to include your parents' information. But on the older students, there shouldn't be any issue.
Okay. So speaking of students that are maybe younger and going to college, mm-hmm. if a family has a college student in college,
yeah.
Does that impact the ability of other family members in the household to receive financial aid?
No. Having multiple students from a household going to college at the same time doesn't necessarily impact the aid eligibility for the other students. Your household size is a determining factor in understanding what kind of financial aid you may qualify for, but it doesn't limit it in terms of what your family could get.
So one person in the family can't necessarily use up all the financial
exactly.
aid and nobody else in the family can, okay.
Correct, yeah.
Okay. So when we say financial aid, is that just grants? I know you mentioned a couple of terms
sure.
earlier that I'm not sure folks are familiar with.
Yeah, no, not a problem at all. So basically, when you fill out your FAFSA application, just to throw it out there again, it's going to determine your eligibility for Pell Grant, which is one of the free grants that the government may extend to a student. Not every student will qualify for that. But then there's also Federal Stafford Loans. So basically, the grants are kind of held for students that have the highest need for them. So the government does a good job of trying to vet that out and kind of apply those funds to students that need it most. If you don't qualify for Pell Grant, or even if you do, you may also qualify for Federal Stafford Loans. But it's different for everybody, and it's, you know, depends on your personal financial situation. So there's no guarantees, But again, it's going to be comprised of really those two components, your Pell Grant and federal Stafford loans. And you can use those in conjunction with one another as well.
What about academic performance? If a student has been struggling or has struggled in the past academically, perhaps gotten poor grades, will that impact their ability to receive financial aid?
It could. Students are required to basically satisfy their school's satisfactory academic progress policies. So there can be instances where students may have trouble with a few courses and maybe have their grade point average slip. And you could end up on probation or maybe not be eligible to receive aid at all. It doesn't happen all that often, but it is out there, and it is different from school to school.
So kind of staying along these lines and really understanding, you know, what's myth and what's true, I want to talk a little bit about ways that students can maximize their eligibility for financial aid.
Sure.
So along those lines, are there specific things that a student can do to maximize that eligibility?
Not really, you know, and that's, you know, people ask that question a lot, you know, my friends, family members, stuff like that, and they look for, you know, tips or tricks they can do, and it doesn't really work that way. But I will say this, there can be times where, you know, we were talking about younger students and older students, and in the financial aid world, they would call that a dependent student versus an independent student, and there are age cutoffs for some of these things. So if you're, you know, right on the cusp of the age requirement, you know, it might be worth waiting that extra month so that you could, you know, try to apply for financial aid on your own without your parents' help. But on the other side of that, it all depends on your household size and your family income. So those slight changes can impact the age you're eligible for. So there's no guarantee that just because you're on your own that you would actually get a more favorable financial aid package than you would with your family. So again, it's one of those things where you kind of have to fill out the application, you know, do it to the best of your ability, make sure it's accurate, and then work with your school to see, you know, what kind of aid package they can put together for you.
Okay. Yeah, it sounds like the bottom line is start with filling out the FAFSA and talk to somebody to get some more information.
Yeah, you've noticed I keep saying that, huh?
Fill out FAFSA, yeah. Mm-hmm. So what kinds of grants are available to students?
So going through the FAFSA application, like I said, folks have heard me say Pell Grant now a few times, but there's also what's called the Supplemental Educational Opportunity Grant. So basically what the government has done is they've set up Pell Grant for needy students, but then they also have set up the SEOG, the Supplemental Educational Opportunity Grant, to kind of help subsidize students if they need additional, you know, grant money or things like that. It's limited for each school, so you never know exactly, you know, how much is out there. But those are kind of the two that you would get from your FAFSA application. Now, AIU does offer, you know, a couple of institutional scholarships and grants and things like that. We have our AIU Advantage Grant. We have the Career Education Scholarship. You know, we have Ed Alliance grants and things like that we offer to our students. But, you know, I encourage students to look for those things. Usually you have to look through the institution's course catalog. All of that will be included in there. So those are a few places students could go to kind of research and see what else is out there.
Okay. Actually, on that note, I have a question from Michelle in Chicago. So thanks, Michelle, for the question. Michelle asks, is it easier to get financial aid for an undergraduate or graduate degree? In other words, do financial aid limits vary if you're pursuing your associate, bachelor, master's degree?
Sure. Yeah, your limits actually do vary as you're going through it. So there are what are called aggregate limits to what you can borrow from the government over time. So the limit for an undergraduate is lower than what it is for a graduate student. But at the same time, most students shouldn't really hit that. It just depends on how long they've been going to school, whether or not they've taken any sort of, you know, stipend, which is just money above and beyond what their tuition cost is. But in general, the process is the same in terms of completing a FAFSA application, completing a master promissory note to actually qualify for the loans. The loans are a graduated system, so a freshman doesn't get the same amount as a graduate student. So as you're progressing through school, the government kind of loosens it up a little bit and allows you to receive a little bit more depending on your grade level.
And how would a student know where they're at on the spectrum of their aggregate loan limit? Is that something they can look up somewhere?
As a matter of fact, if you go to the National Student Loan Database, there is a student side of that, and you can actually go in, and it's where the government houses all of your information. So if you go in there and I, you know, looked you up, for example, mm-hmm. you know, you could see every school that you went to, however many loans you took, whether or not you received Pell Grant.
Not my grades, though?
No, we won't see your grades, but I'm sure they were good. And that's where you'd want to go and look at that. And also, if, you know, say our staff here at AIU would help to counsel you on that, explain to you where you're at, and give you an idea of whether or not it may be an issue for you.
So you mentioned scholarships, and it can be difficult to win or achieve or earn a scholarship.
Yeah.
What are some scholarship options that maybe students forget about that are sort of untapped potential out there?
Yeah, no, that's really a great one, and I kind of tie it back to a previous answer a little bit. I find that most students don't kind of take the basic step to look through the course catalog at whatever institution they're going. Of course, I want students to come to AIU, but I encourage students at every school to look through their course catalogs to see what's out there. The schools have to list everything that they offer in those course catalogs or they can't award it to a student. And I find that students kind of rarely apply for our AIU Advantage Grant. We don't see all that many applications for the Career Education Scholarship Fund, which honestly, they're great ways to get that extra little bit of money if you need it. They're not terribly hard to apply for. And on the one hand, if not a lot of people apply, you have a good chance to receive one of those. But at the same time, I don't think enough students really attempt to get those. As far as, you know, looking for outside scholarships or something like that, you know, I think it's more of a lot of research is involved. There'll usually be some sort of essay and things like that that you need to complete. But you have to look for it to know what's out there.
There are some sites out there where you pay to get information about grants and scholarships. Do you think students should pay, or is that best practice?
My rule of thumb is to never pay for it. Now, I'm sure it's possible that there's some places out there that maybe charge a small fee or to process the application or something along those lines, but I think there's just as many that don't charge you any sort of fees. So my rule of thumb, again, is to steer away from things that charge you to apply and focus on the ones that, you know, will allow you to apply with an essay or not charge you any sort of fee. Just be prepared. It takes a while to hear back. You know, I'd applied for quite a few of them when I went to school, and, you know, I think I heard back of, you know, just a couple of them, and the others I never heard back, and I never actually got one. So you have to keep at it, though, and that's something I encourage most students to do.
So we have another question from Ryan in Florida. Ryan asks, when is the best time to apply for financial aid?
There isn't really a best time, but that can depend on your school. So depending on how your school is structured, whether they're on semesters, trimesters, quarters, however it may be, that will kind of influence your eligibility. So your FAFSA year will start in July 1st and go till June 30th of the next year. So there's not necessarily a good time, per se, just to fill out your FAFSA application. But you'd want to fill out your application and then look at, you know, when does school start at your institution and kind of get an idea of where that falls within the FAFSA year.
I have another question here from Rosemary. Rosemary says, I'm a single mom and I'd like to know how I can be eligible for other grants in addition to Pell Grants. Do you have advice for Rosemary?
I think her best bet would be asking about the Supplemental Educational Opportunity Grant. Most, if not every school, receives some portion of funds from that. Again, it's government money that comes to them. Aside from that, you know, I think she would really want to do more research online and look for, you know, kind of those outside scholarships or grants. But as far as just what you would get from your FAFSA application, it's pretty much limited to your Pell Grant and the Supplemental Educational Opportunity Grant.
So I have another question here from someone in Wisconsin.
Okay.
This person says, I'm at 85 to 90% of my loan limit and have less than a year to graduate. Can I go over my limit?
They won't really let you go over it. Basically what will happen...
And they just... for.
I'm sorry, the Department of Education.
Okay, so it's not a school decision.
No, not at all, no. No, but they do try to limit it to the point because they don't want students ending up with so much debt that there's just no way they can cover it or pay it back later. If he's got about a year left, you know, obviously I'm not sure certain if he was, you know, coming to AIU or if he was going to another school. But the best thing he could do is try not to take any overages, meaning that if his tuition charge was low enough and his eligibility was a little bit higher than that, he could choose not to use that, which would kind of save him a little bit of money if it took longer or if, you know, if he had trouble with a course and had to retake something. That would be the best bet in terms of trying to stretch that last little bit for him. There are situations, though, where when you hit that 100% of your aggregate limit, there's no other funding left, and that does happen to some students.
So what would happen in that situation? A student would begin paying out of pocket to finish their education?
That could happen that way, yeah. So we would, you know, basically we would try to look for, you know, again, are there any grants that we could try to apply? Are there anything we could encourage the student to apply for? And if not, we would offer some sort of payment plan to the student. We're not very strict like some other schools, meaning that we wouldn't require that every penny get paid as you were actually in school with us. We would give you some time after school as well. We wouldn't charge any interest or anything like that. But we do try to help students like that because we understand that, you know, it took me a while to finish school, you know, and that happens sometimes. And maybe you didn't make the greatest decision when you're a little bit younger. So we do try to help students like that when it comes up.
Okay. We have another question. Can a student get things like school supplies or a computer using financial aid?
Yeah, I think people have probably heard me mention the word stipend a few times. And simply put, that just means that your tuition charge is lower than your total eligibility. And your school will basically figure out your maximum eligibility, and they're going to share that information with you. And then you have a decision point as a student. Do I want to receive that maximum eligibility, or do I want to just take exactly what I need to cover my tuition? So if you do need to take out more, then you simply request it. And we'll go ahead and send those funds to you throughout the course of your academic year. Now, a big word of caution here. So I don't know if they caught the answer there. The answer is yes, you know, that you could use money to do that. But at the same time, tying it to the aggregate limit conversation we were just having, if you choose to maximize your aid every single year you're in school, that's how you can end up in a situation where maybe you're getting closer to those aggregate limits. Or again, if your path through college is just taking you a little bit longer than expected, you can kind of creep up on that number. So if you do need to take out more than what you need to help you kind of, you know, make ends meet there, my suggestion is to take the absolute smallest amount that you need to kind of get those ends together.
Those overage that you might take for whether it's for school supplies or computer, is that something that students have to pay back?
It depends. It depends on how your aid award is set up. So if somehow you were completely covered with Pell Grant, well, it's a grant. You wouldn't need to pay it back. Most of our students will not be covered by that. And so generally, if you're taking some sort of stipend from the school, it's going to come from your federal Stafford loans. And they are loans. They do carry interest, and they would need to be paid back. Mm-hmm. That's why I really try to caution students against, you know, borrowing more than what they need. But hey, I took stipends when I went to school, and I could certainly understand that.
So they have their place. It's maybe a matter of just being cautious, it sounds like.
Yeah, and our staff does a really good job of counseling students on that and giving them, you know, an idea of kind of what to do and maybe what to steer away from.
Okay. Jeremy from Atlanta asks, I've received some financial aid, but it's not enough. What are my next steps?
That's a tough question because I'm not exactly sure, you know, what his situation is and kind of maybe why it's not enough. Sometimes it just depends on your program and your overall eligibility. If he just does not have enough to cover the tuition, that's where you want to start looking for, you know, are there any sort of outside scholarships? You know, first I would check the course catalog of the school to see if there's, you know, anything there that you could apply for, either a scholarship or a grant. You know, short of that, it can come down to maybe cash payments. And sometimes you got to do a little budgeting at the house and figure out, you know, is there a little bit of money we can try to put towards this?
Okay. So we have another question about scholarships.
Okay.
This person says, I'm married with children and would like to know about scholarships and grants available to me. So would this be another case of saying to check the school catalog, or are there other places to look?
For that one in particular, if you're looking for something that's very specific to your situation, your best bet is researching online and trying to find, you know, are there places that offer something for, you know, a single mom or something like that. But in general, you know, my advice is still go to the catalog and look and see what's in there. Because again, the outside scholarships, it's hit or miss. You know, some will follow up, some won't. You may get one, you may not. So there's no surefire way to say that you're going to get that grant. So I guess my real answer there is to keep persevering and keep trying and looking for those things.
So going back to, I think, something we talked about earlier, we have another question about what are the government aid options available? Can you count through those one more time for us?
Yeah, not a problem. So again, tying it back to your FAFSA application, because I want to make sure that if folks get anything from this, they know to actually, you know, complete that application. It's the best way to do it. That's going to determine your eligibility first and foremost for Pell Grant, which again is free money from the government that does not require repayment. It'll also determine your eligibility, and again it's limited to your school's funding, but for your Supplemental Educational Opportunity Grant. Then it'll also determine eligibility for federal Stafford loans, which could come in the two types, the subsidized or unsubsidized. And then also, you know, I haven't mentioned these yet, but there's also PLUS loans out there. And kind of back to the credit-based question we had earlier, that is one component that is credit-based. And then parents apply for PLUS loans, or graduate students can apply for PLUS loans.
Okay, thanks. We have another attendee on the webinar asking, are there certain programs, such as business, that have more financial aid options? So is financial aid determined by your area of study?
Kind of a tricky one. So the short answer is no, that your program doesn't necessarily influence it. But when we talk about scholarships and grants, there could be, you know, depending on the institution, again, you know, some scholarship or grant that they offer particular to a business student, let's say. Now, we don't offer something like that that's specific to it. We treat all of our students on a level playing field to make sure that if we have funds out there, we can offer them. We want to make sure everybody gets the chance to apply. But that's not to say that at other places, you know, that might not be the case where they have something specific for a business student.
Okay. So for students who have taken loans out, when would those loans become due? When would they start having to pay the loan back?
That's a great question, and it depends, okay? So usually students will get a 6-month grace period from when they withdraw or graduate school. Now, I kind of brushed over that quickly because I think students generally think, okay, well, it's from when I graduate. But if you leave school, so if I was going to school today and I leave today, my 6-month clock starts ticking. So it's a running tally from when you leave. Now, there's things you can do, say if you have to withdraw, you know, life happens, you know, that you can basically kind of work with your lender, you can attempt to get forbearance and things like that. And in fact, we have a whole team of people here that actually assist students who withdraw or even graduate that need help kind of navigating what to do with their loans to try to preserve their grace periods, you know, give them advice on, you know, things like forbearance, like we talked about, how to make the payments, stuff like that.
Okay. Great. Thank you. So if you're paying down a loan, if you've left school and have begun your repayment period, can you borrow more if you're returning back to a different school or pursuing a different degree, I suppose?
Yeah, as long as you haven't hit your aggregate limits, like we talked about a little bit earlier, as long as you haven't hit that, yeah, you could actually apply for more. And honestly, when you go back to school, your loans can be put into in-school deferment. You would just need to contact your lender and make sure they know that you're going to school. You probably have to work with your current school to get something that affirms that you're actually in school and an active student. Then you would give that to your lender, and your lender would essentially put them on hold until you're out of school again.
I see. Okay. Mm-hmm. So can you elaborate again on where scholarship opportunities are located, whether that's communities, churches, workplace kinds of scholarships, and sort of where should a student start with that?
Sure. So first things first, if I was just, you know, going back to school right now and I had a couple of schools in mind, I would get their course catalogs and I would look through them. I would go to their financial aid or student finance section and I would look through to see what they offer, because from my experience, those are the ones that you're most likely to get, okay? And in general, you can apply for a lot of them multiple times. If you look through those catalogs and you're not really finding much, that's when I kind of encourage students to kind of look outside of the box, you know, and it's as simple as a Google search sometimes, you know, where you can go through if you're looking for something specific and search for that and try to find it. I really shy away from sending people to kind of aggregate scholarship sites, if you will, where they just list a bunch of them, because there can be a lot of scams in there, and I never want to direct somebody to a site that may take advantage of them. So I only say that, again, not to say they're not out there, but I want to give people the right expectation. And I don't want to send people down a rabbit hole trying to find something that may be difficult or may end up, you know, them getting taken advantage of. So just to recap it, start with the course catalog for the schools you're interested in, and then search online and see what else you can get. And then you kind of triggered something when you talked about, you know, if you're working, a lot of employers offer some sort of tuition reimbursement. And I've noticed from our students that not everyone takes advantage of that. So that's something else that you want to do, is check with your employer, see if they offer anything. And then you mentioned, you know, local community stuff. And it's not unreasonable to think that they may have some local scholarships. Those basically go to like a library, a local library. Usually they'll have some stuff posted and you can kind of look there and see if they have it.
So I have a kind of a last question, but it's a little bit of a big one. Ooh. One group that we haven't talked too much about are folks serving in the military and their spouses. What are the financial aid programs available to military service members and their spouses?
Oh, very good. So it just kind of depends. So in terms of their eligibility for, you know, Pell Grant and Stafford loans like we've talked about, that would be pretty much the same as everybody else. But we do offer a military spouse grant. And then it kind of depends on how they've set up their veterans benefits. If they're a veteran, if they're active duty, they would have some sort of maybe tuition assistance that they could use. As far as, you know, GI Bill, it can depend if you're Chapter 33, if you're Chapter 30. Military students, and I feel very passionately about this, have a lot of options out there for them. And the government did a really good job, or the VA did a really good job of setting up a program that can really benefit those students. So kind of first things first for it, you know, like I said, the FAFSA eligibility is not different for a military student, but, you know, our institution does offer something specific to military students, meaning that we offer military pricing to active duty students. You know, we have grants for veterans, we have grants for military spouses. You know, these are things that we offer. But at the same time, again, I can't guarantee that folks will receive all of that. The military tuition rate, that one I can guarantee you. But short of that, the other factors just depend on how the family has set up their benefits, you know, so whether or not you're getting GI Bill from your spouse or something like that.
So for a spouse who's interested in going back to school, the first step would be complete the FAFSA?
You're on to me. Yeah, that's kind of the adage here that I wanted people to get is complete that FAFSA application, you know, go to those net price calculators, you know, look at ours, look at other schools' net price calculators and see kind of what's out there because that's kind of the only way you're really going to get an idea without completing a FAFSA application.
Can I complete the FAFSA online?
Of course. Yeah, way back, man, when I was younger, we'll say. They had actually made everything automated. So you could do a paper FAFSA application and mail it in. But these days, you know, you just want to go right into the FAFSA website, complete it, import your taxes, which, like I said, will be the fastest way to do it. And then once they have that done, they'll send information to the schools you select.
Great. So we mentioned the net price calculator, I think, is on the screen for folks to check out today. Thanks for your time.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for having me.
Thanks, everybody, for attending. Hopefully you learned something new about financial aid eligibility today.